promoting a healthy environment. It's the air we breathe. Clean, safe water. Responsible management of our natural resources to protect and restore for a sustainable future. Environment matters.
I'm amazed, and it's just wonderful. I mean, people haven't seen fish in here for a long time.
A recovery that's nothing short of spectacular. A new water treatment project is making a big splash. Plus, finding a new home for some old electronics that doesn't involve a trip to the landfill. Hello everyone, and welcome to Environment Matters. I'm Greg Adolfson with the West Virginia Department of Environmental Protection. Everyone likes a good comeback story, overcoming the odds to triumph over adversity. But there's more to this story than that, because it's a story about coming back from the dead. The DEP's Mike Huff has the details.
The water is clear now, but it wasn't that long ago that Three Fork Creek in Preston and Taylor counties was fouled by acid mine drainage. Coal mining within Three Fork Creek watershed dates back to the mid-1800s and left roughly 9,100 acres of untreated mine pools discharging into its headwater tributaries.
This watershed's been heavily mined prior to 1977. There weren't regulations during that time. And as a result of that, we still have drainage that comes from those old mines. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty acidic, a lot of iron, a lot of aluminum. And most of that occurs upstream of this point.
That acid drainage left more than 17 miles of Three Fork Creek essentially dead, lifeless except for a few tolerant insect species, and continued to cause pollution problems downstream as it emptied into the Tiger River and beyond.
Acid mine drainage was terrible. This stream has been dead for almost 50, 60 years back in the 50s. At one time, this was one of the best trout streams in West Virginia for this area.
In 2004, the West Virginia Division of Natural Resources determined that Three Fork Creek was the second highest contributor of acid mine drainage in the entire Monongahela River Basin. It was clear something had to be done, but what?
A lot of the areas, we've done some small at-source projects to try to remediate the water, but that's such a small area and such a small amount of drainage that we didn't see like an overall impact on the stream. And so we decided to try to improve the whole watershed and improve the fisheries here.
And that meant trying something new. This is a lime dosing station, one of four installed along the tributaries that form Three Fork Creek by the West Virginia Department of Environmental Protection's Office of Abandoned Mine Lands. This station, along Birds Creek, is powered by water from the stream. A measured amount of lime is added, creating an alkaline solution. When added to the stream, it neutralizes the acid.
By changing the pH, you also allow metals to drop out and other things that can harm the fish, and so you get improved water farther downstream.
The lime dosing stations have been in place for just over a year, and as for their effectiveness...
I'm amazed. This is a large stonefly. It's the largest stonefly that we have in West Virginia. Generally, it occupies the small headwater streams. This is probably the most sensitive organism I found this week. So that's a real good sign. And the trout streams in West Virginia, they love them. These are like one of their mainstays. So it's really nice to see that.
Does it surprise you in that short a time that there's been this big of a difference?
Absolutely. But I'm amazed, and it's just wonderful. I mean, people haven't seen fish in here for a long time, and so it's pretty crazy.
That's quite a change from 2009, the last time the DEP surveyed Three Fork, and 2 years before the lime dosing stations were put online.
Yeah, basically the last time, I guess it was in 2009, we didn't find
anything.
We shocked this for fish and found no fish whatsoever, and we found only the most tolerant benthic macroinvertebrates, the bugs, and now we're seeing stoneflies, we're seeing some helgramites. Haven't seen a crayfish yet. I'm expecting to see one of those maybe in a couple of years, which would definitely be a benefit. But things are looking better. It's been an amazing turnaround, actually. And it's been better than I even thought it would be.
This year, survey crews documented more than 1,600 fish, including 21 different species, at the same four test sites as the 2009 survey. A dramatic change, to say the least.
Are you surprised about the how big of a change it's been?
Oh, yes. In a short period of time, about 14 months, we went to practically a zero in fish and other wildlife to amazing recovery here on Three Forks Creek. We are very elated with the cooperation we've had with the DEP in cooperation with them and our watershed association. We have formed a great partnership here, and it's resulted in this great recovery.
But that recovery has not been cheap. The mine drainage into Three Forks Creek is high in metals and low in pH, a combination that rapidly reduces the effectiveness of passive treatment systems. The four active dosers cost just over $750,000 to construct, and operating and maintaining them averages over $18,000 a month. The project is funded through the West Virginia Acid Mine Drainage Set-Aside account. That account is currently at $41 million, and program managers hope that in the future, as contributions from abandoned mine lands continue, the interest from that fund will make the project self-sustaining. In Preston County, I'm Mike Huff for Environment Matters.
Program managers say the project has exceeded the expectations of everyone involved, and the knowledge and experience gained over the last 15 months will allow volunteers and staff to operate the dosers in a more proactive manner, improving efficiency and cost savings. They say the hope that the Three Forks Creek project will become a model for future projects. Watershed groups from all across the state were recently honored by the West Virginia Watershed Network for their efforts in protecting and restoring local watersheds. Watershed Celebration Day was September 7th. More than 100 volunteers and providers attended the festivities held this year at the Coal River Group Science and Education Center in Tornado. Organizers say that when it comes to watershed health, help from volunteer groups like this is invaluable.
People who are doing this kind of work and are not getting paid for it, they're doing it because they have a passion. And for the Department of Environmental Protection and all of the resources that we work with, it's huge because those folks are out there doing things in their community, and the value that we get from it is that we have stakeholders and people who care, and when we go in and spend a bunch of money on a project, those people will be there when we go away.
The West Virginia Watershed Network is an informal group set up to help local residents make decisions for sustainable management of their resources. Taking top honors this year was the Warm Springs Watershed Association. Warm Springs Run is part of the larger Potomac River watershed. The group was recognized for its efforts in taking a proactive approach to developing a stream restoration plan and its community outreach efforts, something group members say is critical to their mission.
We recognize that restoration is going to have to take place with really an educated population. Not coming in and saying, hey, there are problems here or there are future potential problems here and you guys you need to do something. We started out with a really strong educational program.
For a full list of this year's winners, please visit our website, dep.wv.gov. The DEP will be sponsoring a free two-day workshop on the effects of stormwater runoff on the state streams and rivers. The workshop, which will be held October 16th and 17th at the Big Sandy Superstore Conference Center in Huntington, is geared toward officials and communities who operate municipal separate storm sewer systems, but it is open to any organization with an environmental message. Seating is limited to 50 people. To find out more or to register for the workshop, give us a call here at the DEP at the number on your screen. They are, at best, eyesores. At their worst, they present a danger to public health and safety and are a hindrance to economic redevelopment. We're talking about brownfields, abandoned properties that have or are perceived to have contamination from previous site activity. Cleaning them up and returning them to something useful presents challenges, but also opportunities. And that was the message at the West Virginia Brownfields Conference in Raleigh County.
They came from all corners of the state, developers, community leaders, and government officials, for a chance to meet with experts in brownfield redevelopment, pick their brains, and then take what they'd learned back to their communities. Conference attendees heard presentations on renewable energy, site assessment, and the latest regulatory updates impacting potential projects. The theme for this year's conference, brownfields, a piece of the redevelopment puzzle.
You know, and brownfields take on so many roles. It's not just the old gas station on the corner. It's not just the big service line property. It can be old residential houses that have long since decayed and are abandoned. You know, the asbestos siding on them and things of that nature. So right off the bat, you've got so many different types. In addition to the traditional brownfields, the industrial sites, the old rail yards and the old chemical plant sites, those types of things. So any property that where you've had people doing some kind of activity on them could potentially be a brownfield, actually. So with that, you have a lot of different opportunities on how you might be able to redevelop those properties.
George Carrico is program coordinator with the Southern West Virginia Brownfields Assistance Center at Marshall University. The center at Marshall serves West Virginia's southern counties. A similar program at WVU takes care of the state's northern counties. He says one big advantage to brownfield properties can often be summed up in three words: location, location, location.
These are in prime locations right in these communities where there used to be development, there used to be things happening, now there aren't. Redeveloping those lands, you've already got the infrastructure there, you know, a lot of cases you've got the roads, got the utilities that are in place. So it makes perfect sense to redevelop that part. Now the environmental aspect of it, it can be challenging without question. Every site's different. Some sites it's a minimal environmental issue. Some sites can be pretty complex. But we always tell people, don't let the environmental hurdle stop your project. If you've got a really good project, don't worry about the environmental part. We'll figure out how to work with it.
This is the seventh year for the conference. The West Virginia Brownfields Assistance Centers help communities that lack the resources or technical expertise to take on brownfield redevelopment projects on their own. To find out more, you can check out their website, wvbrownfields.org. Coming up, there are those old televisions, game consoles, and laptops still running Windows 98. All the obsolete electronics most of us have gathering dust around the house. We'll check out a recycling event that helps keep them out of the landfill. But first, did you know your old computer, DVD player, or cell phone can be a gold mine? E-cycling can recycle and reuse scarce precious metals like gold, platinum, and iridium, and saves natural resources by reducing mining and processing. E-cycling also helps avoid land, air, and water pollution by capturing and reusing hazardous substances like lead or chromium. We're back in a moment.